Imagine going down to the river, seeing some fish eggs, and accidentally discovering the species of parasite that would drive scientists crazy for the next 150 years.
Well, it wasn't technically a fish, and it wasn't your usual parasite either. In fact, I couldn't even find a source to back up that there even was a Professor Ozienikov who was researching strelitz in the Volga River in 1871 when this species was discovered. This is a reoccurring theme in this story. The more you look into it, the less it makes sense. Nonetheless, by the turn of the century, we know that Russian scientists are looking into the existence of an odd-looking parasite living within the eggs of a small freshwater sturgeon. What's a sturgeon? Well, it's basically just a shark if it looked like it was a million years old. Named a decade later the Polypodium hydroform, this was the start of an 150-year struggle to understand and classify these small animals. For every single time there was a new discovery on how they behave and why, they seemed to defy all previously established categories of not just the Cnidaria phylum, but of the animal kingdom itself. Let's start by imagining we're doing a dissection and analyzing the structure and function of these animals. They first appear as tiny cells with two small nuclei. The smaller of the two nuclei then forms a cell wall around itself until it is essentially a cell within a cell. But remember, this is all within a sturgeon's egg, making them animals that live essentially as cells inside cells inside cells. They live in communities inside these eggs until when these eggs are laid, they explode outwards, consuming the egg from the inside out into what in other cnidarians is called their medusa stage. See how it's got all the arms, the stingers, every single aspect that makes it look like a convincing cnidarian, and why it was classified as such in the late 19th century. But then if they have a shared ancestry with other cnidaria, like sea anemones and medusa jellies, how did they get to be so small, live in fresh water, and be parasites at all? Myxozoa is a subphylum of cnidaria that, up until recently, wasn't thought of to be part of that phylum at all. Instead, they were thought to be protozoa, that phylum of animals that we learned about that are unicellular and are still animals. But they aren't, and were instead given their own clade under the phylum Cnidaria. Myxozoans are the smallest animals ever known to have lived, as parasites that have lost almost all of what makes them multicellular animals over the course of their genetic history. They can grow in everything from fish to worms to, like the Polypodium hydroform, the cells of other animals. Some are so derived that they can't even do basic functions like cellular signaling, or in the case of this myxozoan, cellular respiration, meaning that it's technically the only animal that can't breathe. This study from 2015 puts the Polypodium hydroform in the same sort of category as myxozoa, but hesitates to actually classify them under that clade. And if you're struggling to understand why, you're not the only one. Myxozoans are cnidarians. They have the stingers and the life cycle that makes them related to deep sea jellies and even coral, just like the Polypodium hydroform. So more studies have been done, going to the genetic level and comparing certain sequences against other cnidarian subphylums. As you can see here, they compared them against practically everything. And suddenly, it looks like the microscopic parasitic myxozoa is just as related to the Polypodium hydroform as hydrozoa, a completely different cnidarian clade. Hydrozoa are usually saltwater jellies that live almost entirely in their polyps form, but they include species like Portuguese man-of-war and are usually bigger and more complex than myxozoa. And yes, the Polypodium hydroform does spend most of its life in this Russian doll-like cell within a cell within a cell form, the stage that we can presume is this animal's polyps form. But this isn't something unique to hydrozoa. In fact, in the complete other class of cnidaria, anthozoa, which includes species like corals and sea anemone, they never actually leave their polyps form at all. Side note, there are three main subphylums under the big umbrella of cnidaria. There are the myxozoa, the parasites, the stupidly tiny ones. There's the anthozoa, the ones where if you pass by them in the aquarium as a kid, you probably just assumed they were seafloor decoration. Then there's medusozoa, the hydrozoa you've never heard of, and all the jellies that you definitely have. Cnidaria themselves are more complex than sponges, for example, but less complex than bilaterians, which include almost all other animals. So they're old, really old, older than most of animal life, but they aren't so old that they have no structure. Speaking of bilateria, turns out these studies I mentioned, well, they started comparing how closely related the Polypodium hydriform is to bilateria like starfish and worms. Turns out, very, meaning that these guys are so weird that they might not even be that genetically similar to other members of their own phylum. But even then, it might have just been something called long branch attraction, a type of error that happens in genetic sequencing. At this point, it's anyone's guess. When I was doing my first preliminary research on the Cnidaria phylum, two things stood out to me. The first was that this was a class with only one order, only one family, and only one genus. It's puzzled scientists and researchers so much that every study I looked at even places it slightly differently on the phylogenetic tree. The second was just the sheer amount of questions I was left with the more and more I read into this species. Is there something particular to the eggs of the 18 kinds of freshwater sturgeon that makes it so this genus evolved this way? And why did it evolve so monotypically? Or why is there only one genus in this class? Did it evolve as a more complex mycozoan, or an extremely derived hydrozoan, or is it simply just a relic? The last surviving species of a line that predates or even overlaps the phyla of Bilateria and Cnidaria. As our ability to look into the genetic makeup of these microscopic creatures improves, maybe then we'll be able to answer some of these questions and fill in the gaps left by all the contradicting evidence. Or maybe we'll only be left with more questions. Or even, as one of these studies poses, we have to rethink the way that we classify animals entirely. Thank you for joining us on a new episode of our show. None of this would have been possible without the support of viewers just like you, so make sure to like, comment, and hit that subscribe button down below. Thank you so much, and see you next time. None of this would have been possible.